I just had to sneak up on Ricky Martin. He's so cute.
Everybody, and I mean everybody, wanted Ricky Martin.
If you're sexy, funny, smart, unbelievably talented, that good looking, everybody wants to take a shot at it.
There are constantly questions about Ricky Martin's sexuality.
And if you fly too high, when you come down, it's going to hurt. So spiritually, emotionally, you have to be solid.
I can look at Ricky's journey and know that he is focused on where he wants to be.
Every step of the way, he did whatever he had to do with pride and with joy.
Even as a boy growing up in San Juan, Puerto Rico, Ricky Martin was destined for the media spotlight.
He went from being this shy, lanky kid playing with his friends in the park to like being in front of hundreds of thousands of kids every night. So his life changed completely.
His hard work and talent would turn him into a global megastar and an international sex symbol.
What's amazing, hot, sexy, no word. See this? See this?
He could walk out onto that stage with the ability to sing, dance, and entertain. A lot of people can do little pieces of that. Ricky's the whole package.
In the beginning, almost more than anything, was the sex appeal of Ricky Martin. I mean, male, female, gay, straight, you couldn't deny it. He was electric on stage.
But the pace of stardom and demands of the media would eventually invade too deeply into Ricky's personal life.
I give it all when I'm on stage. I give it all when I'm in front of cameras. So when I lock myself in my room, that key belongs to me. That key is not for sale.
In March of 2010, after years of evading questions about his sexuality, Ricky finally unlocked the door and came out of the closet. Admitting he was, quote, a fortunate homosexual man, not only set Ricky free, but also allowed him to stand strong as a father and musician.
I came out because I had the need to pretty much be free and be happy with myself.
In 1998, Ricky Martin was a rising star in Latin America, yet throughout the rest of the world, he was virtually unknown. But all of this would change when Ricky was commissioned to write and perform the theme song for the 1998 World Cup, La Copa de la Vida, or The Cup of Life.
Ale, ale, ale. This song is dance. This song is full of drums. That is strength.
The groove on it is just powerful. Groove alone, the track stands alone, just on pure groove, you know, and everything else is just like icing.
I am a football fan. That's what I wanted to present throughout music as well. What I feel when I'm in a stadium.
When Ricky stepped in front of the mic, it just totally came to life. And he was made for this song.
The single performance of The Cup of Life transformed Ricky from a Latin performer into an international sensation.
Performing Copa de la Vida for the World Cup was a defining moment in his career. It was such a huge world platform that it was really what he needed at the time.
The beauty of the World Cup performance was it took this great artist that could connect with an international audience and instantly put him on an international stage and connected him with the biggest sporting event in the world.
He sings that song halftime in the final in front of a crowd of 65,000 in France, but a TV audience of over 1.5 billion.
Performing in front of over 1 billion viewers worldwide is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, and Ricky prepared to take full advantage of the international spotlight by recording the song in multiple languages.
I did one in Spanish. I have to. It's a must. French, we are in France. In English, it's an international language.
Like wildfire, the song spread across the world. And it soon caught the attention of the Grammy committee.
So of course the song gets nominated for Best Latin Song in the Grammys. And lo and behold, he gets an invite to perform at the Cup of Life.
When I remember sitting around with different people who were crafting that television show back then, wondering who this kid was, because some of them hadn't seen him or heard of him before. Others were very supportive. But there were some questions about who he was and could he actually deliver.
We had a tremendous amount of leverage, so to speak, with the Grammys at that time. And I was able to use that leverage to get Ricky on the show and get him one of the premier spots to perform.
It was a make-or-break opportunity, made only more challenging by the notoriously hard-to-impress Grammy audience.
Typically, the audience at the Grammy Awards are the music industry. So you have all the producers, the managers, the artists. This is not like your normal arena crowd. These are the professionals. They're really not impressed by a lot.
It's definitely a minefield. It's a catch-22 situation because even though the Grammys is a great platform for you to perform, it could also be your pitfall if you don't do it right. And the road is littered with artists that have gone to the Grammys to perform what was going to be the water cooler moment the next day, and they fizzled.
And I remember sitting with Ricky in a quiet moment after sort of everybody else had moved away, and he looked over to me and he said, "You know, I'm a little nervous about tomorrow. How intense, how crazy should I get when I get out on that stage?" And I looked at him and I just said, "You've done this before. You just have to go out and do what you do, and you do really well, which is be in the moment, have as much fun as you possibly can, and don't leave anything back in the dressing room."
Ricky Martin knew he would never get a better chance to impress the U.S. market.
National telecast, Grammys, everyone who cares about music will be watching tonight. It's what you've been waiting for. It's a make or break moment. Do you really want it? Yeah! Do you really want it? Yeah! Here we go! Ale, ale, ale! Go, go, go! Ale, ale, ale! Tonight, tonight, gonna celebrate the Cup of Life! Ale, ale, ale!
The sheer energy that Ricky Martin brought to the stage that night electrified the entire audience.
That jaded industry crowd that sits in those first 20 rows of the Grammy Awards spontaneously jumped up and gave him a standing ovation. That doesn't happen every Grammy performance.
Rosie O'Donnell, who was the host that evening, said the famous lines, "Oh my God, I had no idea who he was before then, but now I know, and now everybody knows."
It was an exhilarating performance that showed the world that Ricky Martin was going to be the next biggest superstar globally.
In one shining moment, everyone wanted to be a part of his energy, his sexuality, his sheer magnetism.
The post-Grammy moment for Ricky Martin was one where he had brought the house down at the Grammys and then backstage been anointed by Madonna, who wanted him in all of her photographs.
Hi, baby.
Oh, love, how are you?
Hey. Have you met my new friend, Ricky Martin, who I just met?
Sorry, I just had to sneak up on Ricky Martin. He's so cute.
Well, the Grammys, I must say, was one of the most fascinating nights of my career. Very special evening. I have not been able to wind down.
The next day, everybody wants to know, who the hell is this guy?
Ricky took the American media by storm, exciting the nation with his Latin sex appeal and energetic personality.
Ricky was invited to do the Tonight Show, Good Morning America, the Today Show. He did every single major television show in the mainstream marketplace. He was on the cover of Time and Newsweek, cover of Rolling Stone, cover of People magazine. He was all over the place, and he suddenly became the media darling.
Ricky Martin's success was a lot like the Beatles. He was mobbed, followed. Fans were around him 24/7. They loved him. And he loved them back.
To walk in the door and to see everybody from the airport waiting for me and asking for pictures and autographs was very flattering.
Ricky's popularity was so huge that he even earned an invite to perform for the President of the United States.
He went from being someone you had never heard of to, you know, playing the inauguration of President Bush.
Ricky's performance at the inauguration was fun and whimsical. but it also raised a few eyebrows.
Somebody more seasoned in the ways of American pop culture might not have performed at a presidential inauguration, because just by definition of doing that, you may be alienating about half of the audience.
It wasn't that he was there saying, hey, I believe in the Republican agenda. He was just there because he believed in America. And it was a chance for the Bush administration to prove that they believed in the Latin American community, at least enough to have one of them come and sing and dance.
You know, to go from zero to the inauguration was an incredible accomplishment. Everybody, and I mean everybody, wanted Ricky Martin, even the president.
How did a young boy from the barrios of San Juan, Puerto Rico, become a cultural icon?
I just go back to the beginning. The beginning is San Juan, Puerto Rico, where I was born.
In 1999, Ricky Martin became an international sensation. But Ricky was not born into show business. In fact, he had a very ordinary start to life. Ricky entered the world as Enrique Jose Martin Morales on Christmas Eve of 1971 in Hato Rey, a small peninsula in the Puerto Rican capital of San Juan.
He had a very normal, loving childhood. You know, unfortunately his folks got divorced when he was two, but he had a very, very healthy home life with his mom, with his dad, with his brothers. It's still a very tight family.
You know, I was a normal kid. I would just, my bicycle, my friends, my girlfriends, the beach.
Despite his simple upbringing, little Ricky had an extraordinarily precocious vision of his destiny.
Dad, I want to be an artist. What? What are you talking about? Nobody in my family is in the show business.
When he was four, when he was five, he kind of knew. There was something in him that really knew that this was going to be part of his life.
I always had the need to be in front of a camera. Even, you know, the home video, I would always just pretend.
Most parents would consider showbiz dreams of a six-year-old child to be far-flung. But Ricky's father took him seriously and helped him to get started.
His dad went out, got him a headshot, got him an agent, took him very seriously, which means one of two things. Either his father saw the raw talent as little Ricky was dancing around the house, or Ricky was just persistent. Ricky just wouldn't shut up about it until he got his headshot and his agent.
My first time in front of a camera was for a TV commercial when I was 6 years old. So I guess that triggered a lot of things within me.
Dad sent him on a couple casting calls, and he landed two commercials, one for Burger King and one for Orange Crush. So he started getting his feet wet and feeling good about it.
Acting in commercials was Ricky's first step into showbiz. Still, he had his eyes on a much bigger goal, joining the immensely popular Puerto Rican boy band Menudo.
Menudo was so big that I can't really even compare it to anything else.
Menudo was it. Menudo was like the essence of like the boy band. Imagine NSYNC, New Kids on the Block, 98 Degrees, all wrapped into one.
Made up of five teenage Puerto Rican boys aged 12 to 16, Menudo was the Latin boy band.
Well, what kid in Puerto Rico didn't want to be in Menudo? That was the dream, I think, of every child, every little boy in Puerto Rico.
So to join Menudo was like winning the lottery 10 times over. So he kept bugging his parents about joining Menudo, Menudo.
His parents brought him to the auditions, but it would take Ricky a number of tries before he would get the gig.
First time he got turned down because he was too young. He waited a year, went back to audition again. This time, they said he was too small.
Ricky's third and last chance to fulfill his dream of joining Menudo was made even more difficult because he was auditioning to replace the most popular member at the time, Ricky Melendez.
Ricky had the personality and the charm, and once he took that stage, he won everybody over.
The fact that he was rejected twice speaks volume about his discipline, about what he wants, and how he has that laser vision. I mean, they talk about persistence and never giving up on your dream. That's the perfect example of never giving up on your dream.
Suddenly, he was a star in Menudo, everything he ever dreamed of. And he was on private jets, he was in five-star hotels.
At age 12, Ricky's day-to-day routine dramatically changed.
He went from being this, you know, kid in basically elementary school to being this pop superstar. All of a sudden, flying all over the world or performing in front of thousands and thousands of screaming fans.
Staying in presidential suites in the best hotels, ordering room service and nobody questioning him about you can't order this or can't do that. You tell me what 12-year-old kid has access to that?
But you've got to think, when you start working that hard, that young, you're giving up something, something most of us call a childhood.
First class travel and room service may sound great, but with them came sacrifice.
These were kids that were traveling the whole time. They had tutors in their hotel rooms. They really didn't have a life. I mean, they were performing all the time.
The training that those kids got, they were on the road. I mean, it's a grueling experience, and it has a negative effect on at least half of the people.
The rigorous performance schedule taught Ricky about the importance of hard work in the entertainment industry.
It's on-the-job training, learning how to do it in front of the audience.
But he loved it. I mean, I think it's in him to be a performer. He enjoyed every minute, performing, singing, rehearsals, being famous, traveling.
It was what Ricky was designed to do. And that boot camp really harnessed all of those dreams and all that energy that he had. And he made use of that kind of discipline for the rest of his career.
The discipline that he has nowadays certainly comes from Menudo. The waking up at 6 in the morning, going to a radio station at 7, and just working the whole day on through the night, and then going into the recording studio at midnight till 6 in the morning, that certainly comes from Menudo.
Menudo was playing to huge stadium crowds in Europe, Asia, and the United States.
Menudo was huge. It was the way that everybody got to know. Been the biggest international Latin arena along with where Ricky was.
More important of how big Menudo was, that we all know it was crazy, is how good he behaved and how professional he was that young, and how he actually decided to step out of it and learn from it.
I always remember Ricky kind of being one of the stars of the group, the one that really stood out.
But just as Ricky was becoming a teen idol, it was time for him to leave the band. Unlike other boy bands, Menudo had a revolving door policy when it came to its members.
The beauty about Menudo was that as the kids would grow up, they could be replaced by another Menudo.
Once they reach a certain age or a certain height, they had to leave the group. When Ricky turned 17, it was his turn to leave Menudo. It was very sad, not only for him, but for the fans. And I feel it's really hard for that boy singing his last songs with the group and saying goodbye. But he did it. He did it really well. And everybody just left crying, crying, and crying. And the fans accepted the new member. They had no other choice.
The question now was, without Menudo, who was Ricky Martin?
There's a time where you have to go away and grow up and reassess who you are and how you want to present yourself to the world as the man that you are, not the boy from the band.
In 1988, 17-year-old Ricky Martin was forced out of the spotlight when it came time for him to leave the Latin boy band Menudo.
Menudo's not forever. You leave when you're 16 or 17 years old, or get too much facial hair, or your voice gets too deep, or whatever. He had to just go back to being a high school student in Puerto Rico.
But for Ricky, that wasn't enough. He needed to figure out how to get back into the spotlight.
It's very hard to transcend being in any kind of kiddie group, much less a group that's so hugely successful.
When all that stardom goes away, and all the trappings of stardom, and all the people saying yes to you go away, suddenly you feel really lonely. And you probably feel a little bit persecuted and insulted that people are no longer kind of falling at your feet. It's why child stars always have so much trouble adjusting to the real world once their ride comes to an end.
Ricky was smart enough to recognize that he needed time to figure things out.
There's a time where you are changing, where you are growing up. You're going from the kid to the man, and there's a time where you have to go away and grow up and reassess who you are.
And after being 5 years on that express train called Menudo, the guy needed to decompress. So he went to New York, and he chilled for a couple months, and just trying to get his bearings right.
Living on his own for the first time, Ricky needed to work, and he was not too proud to exploit his previous life as a teen idol. By chance, he met the Arellanos family, who owned a store that specialized in Menudo collectibles. Ricky was soon hired to bring in the crowds.
On the weekends, my store was packed. The fans would buy the merchandise, go to the back, he would sign it for them, speak to them. He was awesome because I'm telling you, his personality is that people want to keep meeting him and seeing him. So every weekend, our business was packed.
Being close to his fans was important to Ricky, but he wanted to be more than just an ex-Menudo heartthrob.
One day he got a call from a friend in Mexico who said, hey, come on down, come hang out for the weekend. So he went down to visit her.
The woman named Angelica Maria, she's very famous. She's one of the biggest performers in Mexico. She loved Ricky. She had a show going and offered Ricky a part in it.
He did a telenovela in Mexico, Alcanzar una Estrella, and it was very successful. And out of that telenovela, there was a pop group that was created within the telenovela. They went on the road, did a tour in Mexico, and out of that, there was the interest from various labels, because they knew who he was a proven entity.
Every move Ricky made helped to catch the attention of music execs at Sony.
It was like, okay, we know who this guy is. He's a talented performer, he's a good-looking guy, and he has a humongous track record, being Menudo.
What finally got him through was his talent. And he knew that that's what would get him through, and he was willing to start all over again.
The one thing that a lot of people don't realize that Ricky went from playing to 250,000 people to maybe 1,000. But he was very smart to know that he was just building a solid fan base that was dedicated to him.
In 1991, 3 years after his departure from Menudo, Ricky launched his first self-titled solo album in Spanish.
The first record was not a great record. The recording budget was minimal. The production of it was not a part of what he'd been used to with Menudo.
It's really difficult to leave something that is so popular, to be a part of something that is so popular, and then try to repeat that on your own without all these other elements that really helped you achieve your fame.
His first solo album left record execs unimpressed, and Ricky had to convince them to give him one last chance.
This was the first time that he had to convince people, I am not washed up, and I am not a one-hit wonder, I'm not a flash in the pan, I'm the real deal.
And that second album later got him a couple of nominations at the Billboard Awards. He won some awards with that, and he actually started selling more units, and then the venue started packing.
And he worked that crowd, and he worked that audience, and he worked the radio stations, he played the theaters, he worked his way up to playing arenas, and then eventually played stadiums.
Riding high on the success of his second Spanish album, Mi Amarras, Ricky continued to excite critics and fans with the 1995 recording of his third album, A Medio Vivir.
By the third album, A Medio Vivir, the one that contained Maria, it was like, wow. This is a home run. He hit a home run. This is going to be a big record.
The home run hit, Maria, brought Ricky overseas to Europe.
Maria helped me get to know myself a little better. We never expected Maria to be such a big hit.
France, of all places in Europe, decided to pick up on that record because of that song, Maria. Next thing you knew, it was spreading like wildfire in the continent. And that was the beginning of Ricky Mania, if you will, in 1995.
Ricky was a hit, proving to critics and fans that he could have a successful solo career, a dream that few child stars had achieved.
There's always something really admirable about an entertainer. You hear about movie stars doing it after the height of their career, they're forced to go audition for a role, and then they get the part, and then they win the Oscar, and those are great stories. Well, Ricky Martin has that story. He was this big star in Menudo, then he was back being a high school kid, then he cut an album and it didn't work, and then he just kept on going.
I think Ricky had his eye on a long-term performance career. And he was very diligent about doing whatever he felt he needed to do to get there. So I think he was someone who got good advice and he followed it.
Yeah, when Ricky came out in his solo career in the Latin market, he was very well received because Ricky was ready. I mean, he was so ready, so focused, so prepared to be a solo artist. That's what made the difference.
Well, he felt like he was one of the lucky ones because 98% of the kids who were part of Menudo didn't have anything afterwards. So by signing with CBS, Sony back then, he felt like he'd been given a second chance, and he was going to do it slowly, like I said, block by block.
Ricky had established himself as a huge Spanish star, but would he have what it takes to make the big crossover into the U.S. market?
Just because you do it in one language doesn't mean you're going to do it in another.
Ricky Martin's career in showbiz began with the boy band Menudo when he was just 12 years old. But at the age of 17, he had to leave the group. No longer in the spotlight, Ricky was forced to re-examine his life.
What he did is he stepped out of the whole thing, tried to move to different place, different country, and start again from zero, which is amazing because he made himself again.
Leaving everything he knew behind in Puerto Rico, Ricky traveled to the U.S. and Mexico to reinvent himself as a solo artist. By the age of 24, Ricky had done just that. But his success was limited to Spanish-speaking audiences.
It seems to me that his plan for becoming a solo artist and just being well-known and accepted worldwide was always something that he kept following through on.
In 1999, Ricky's hit La Copa de la Vida was nominated for Best Latin Song at the 41st Annual Grammy Awards. This song, along with his show-stopping performance, set the stage for the release of his first English album.
It was not until the Grammys and La Copa de Vida that the rest of the world, the Anglo market, really found out about Ricky Martin. It was a golden opportunity to begin the process of breaking Ricky in English.
Sony Music, Columbia, proposed the idea to record an English album. Of course, we gotta do it.
This album would have his biggest hit ever, Livin' La Vida Loca.
We had the album ready to go. We launched the album a week later. La Vida Loca was on the album. And before we had a chance, radio was all over that record. Let's go put it to your brain. Come on now.
First time we heard Living La Vida Loca, it was wow. Get out of the way. This is a number one. It sold 980,000 units, which is unheard of for a Latin artist at that time.
You couldn't do anything without hearing or seeing or talking about Ricky Martin and La Vida Loca.
It was just a great song. La Vida Loca has incredible energy. It still works today. It comes on the radio and you can't help but shake your booty to it.
To this day, I hear it all the time, in TV shows, in movies, in literature.
The sound and attitude of Livin' La Vida Loca had Americans everywhere singing and dancing to Latin music.
Ricky is a huge star internationally, so when the American audience slowly warmed up to him and then La Vida Loca kicked in, he kicked everyone's ass.
And that song was an extraordinary song. Among other things, it was one of the first times that MTV played a Spanglish song.
I don't think he thought it was going to become the anthem and the pop culture tsunami that it became.
Ricky's success opened the doors for other Latin artists to get their music on America's airwaves.
He whetted the appetite for a lot more Latin singers. Fortunately, there were a whole lot of really good Latin singers sort of crossing over at that same time.
Enrique came out with Bailamos. Jennifer Lopez debuted her recording career with a Spanish language track. Mark Anthony. And there was like suddenly like seven artists following Ricky's footsteps, and they were dubbed part of the Latin explosion.
Ricky Martin was the fuse that created the Latin explosion. There's no question in my mind. There's a lot of talented artists, a lot of talented Latin artists. That was Ricky creating that explosion.
With Ricky leading the way, the sudden explosion of Latin music in the U.S. was seen by the Hispanic community as the mainstream acceptance they had sought for so long.
We are so proud of Ricky, so, so proud.
Mirale Ricky, mirale Ricky.
When I see Ricky Martin and the success he's had in his life, his career, we are so proud of him because to us, he's like one of our kids.
There are a lot of stereotypes when it comes to Puerto Rico and or Latin America. There are a lot of things that we have to change, and I have the need, and I think I have the power to do this.
This guy comes out of nowhere, if you will, and basically decides to become the ambassador, the face for that minority.
It's like, Ricky, you go boy.
You were an example for all of us.
Ricky did come at a point where a movement had been building up, and he was the catalyst for a lot of people to look very seriously at Latin entertainment.
It was a statement to society, you know? It was kind of like, yeah, this is it. We have a new pop icon. Not just a Latino icon, a new pop icon.
Martin followed the huge success of his first English-speaking record with another, Sound Loaded, which was released in November 2000.
The thought process behind Sound Loaded was strike it while it's hot. Let's get it out now. Let's get it out. Instead of taking a step back and waiting, no. We're on a roll. Let's put it out.
The impact of his second English record paled in comparison to the success of his first.
Ricky released his follow-up album very quickly the following year. And I think that gave the impression of oversaturation, because you had one album, it was huge, and then the next year you had another one, and the singles were similar, Living La Vida Loca, and then She Bangs, and it was like, you know, what is this, like part two?
Some of the choice of material, you know, got questionable at that time, whether it was She Bangs or things like that. I mean, they were fun records. They were certainly not as cutting edge as La Vida Loca.
There's no way that anyone can sustain number one after number one after number one. I mean, you know, at some point you have a number three and that almost seems like a failure, but you know, it really isn't.
The higher they build you, and the highest you climb, is the fall is going to be a lot greater, because that's the way the nature of the beast works. So it does sting.
People began to wonder whether Ricky was just another manufactured pop star.
Any perfect pop star seems overly engineered, too well dressed, too well coiffed, too perfect. It's just easy to hate them. Just as easy to hate them as it is to love them.
At some point, the media stops giving the public what they want and they start shoving someone like Ricky Martin down your throat. The public does not blame the media, they blame Ricky Martin.
Ricky's star was falling. He was no longer the guy that everyone loved. Instead, he became the guy that everyone loved to hate.
Anyone who is so in the public eye, anyone who is so massive, you're gonna have people talking about you. It comes with the territory, and everybody knows that.
For Ricky, the backlash became personal.
If you're, you know, sexy, funny, smart, unbelievably talented, that good looking, everybody wants to take a shot at you.
Yeah, you know, everyone was looking for the flaws in Ricky. Like, who is he? Like, he's one of the world's most handsome men. You know, what's up? What's his story?
I give it all when I'm on stage. I give it all when I'm in front of cameras. So when I lock myself in my room, that key belongs to me. That key is not for sale.
The public was no longer satisfied with just watching Ricky's energetic performances. They wanted to know more about who he was behind closed doors.
There are constantly questions about Ricky Martin's sexuality. He's often photographed on the beach with men. He's often photographed out with women. Does it really matter? Is it any of our business? I'm not sure it is.
Ricky Martin, like a lot of celebrities, has had gay rumors follow him throughout his career. He has alternately said, I'm not gay, to saying the greatest thing you could say about a gay rumor is, look, I'm a pop star, you can fantasize about me however you want.
Being in the media spotlight was no longer fun for Ricky. He wanted out. By 2001, Ricky Martin had released 6 albums with 3 international hits and had won 2 Grammys. He gave everything to his audience and his performances, but he soon grew weary of the public's nagging personal questions and insistence for more. Ricky wanted his life back.
Ricky has led a pace that has at times just boggled my mind. You know, Madrid today, Rio, Miami, we're filming in LA, back again to Mexico City, literally just going, there's no life at that point.
You know, one thing that people don't understand, it's as glamorous as it sounds to fly on a private jet with an entourage of 30 people, it's not really all that. The paparazzis or the hordes of people all over the place. And you kind of need a break from everything else.
With this career, I've met a lot of people, you know. I've been able to exchange ideas and ways of thinking and cultures, etc. But I can count my friends with one hand.
You know, like to make sure, like, you know, he had a life, which is so important, because in the end of the day, hey, we all have careers and we love what we do, and you know, he makes us so happy with his music, but he's a person, he needs to be happy.
It was time for Ricky to take a step back and reassess what was going on around him.
There was a moment when Ricky basically said, I've had enough, I need a break.
The thought process of taking a break is a matter of regrouping. You take a breath and say, well, you know, analyze all the pieces.
I mean, the Ricky mania was crazy. He couldn't go anywhere, he couldn't do anything. You know, I think it was part also of taking a little bit back of his life.
Overwhelmed by his life of constant touring and public scrutiny, Ricky decided to get away.
While Ricky was on hiatus after that whirlwind of La Vida Loca and Soundloaded, he decided to travel around the world, and he went to India. He really fell in love with the country, with the people, the culture, the whole philosophy of India just attracted him.
I went to India. I went to India and I went to Nepal. I must say that I think I had some sort of a spiritual awakening when I was there. It's a trip that definitely changed my life. I felt some sort of comfort that I've never felt before.
This started his yearly pilgrimage, so to speak. I wouldn't call it a pilgrimage, but his yearly travels to India. And he started to meditate, and that apparently has been a key factor in him being able to lead a normal life.
And it really puts him even keeled with who he is as a person and as a human being. And he just travels the countryside for 2-3 weeks, doesn't stay at five-star hotel, you know, grows his beard and just goes in a backpack. And he's just in touch with the people and the energy and the magic that is India.
Ricky's time spent in India infused his life with a new grounded sense of spirituality.
My priority every morning is to keep my feet on the ground, you know. That's the most important thing. Because after so many people telling you, oh, how good you are with music, how good you are on stage, how good, you can start flying too high. And if you fly too high, when you come down, it's gonna hurt. So spiritually, emotionally, you have to be solid.
During these trips, Ricky's eyes were opened to the social and economic hardships that plagued India's streets.
While he was there, he met a friend who asked him one day if he wanted to go help rescue kids. And he's like, rescue kids? What do you mean? He goes, yeah, we're going to go rescue little girls. Yeah, okay, I'll go. He didn't know what it was. He's basically rescuing these poor kids that had been abandoned by their parents, who were selling themselves as prostitutes, or a pimp was selling them. Girls were 9, 11 years old.
I had the opportunity to rescue 3 girls from the streets, and I started educating myself about what would have happened to these girls if organizations like the one I was working with didn't exist. And I was alarmed.
What people have to look at and appreciate about him is that truly is a sincere individual there. It's not an act. This isn't something that turns on with the camera and turns off with the camera.
He does it for real. He does it for himself, and he does it for the girls. That's the difference between Ricky Martin and anybody else helping.
Ricky did not just talk about what he saw. He took immediate action.
So he was shocked by the experience, and that later led to him creating the Ricky Martin Foundation, you know, to advocate for children's rights, whether it's sexual exploitation, child trafficking, whatever it is. That's what the purpose of the Ricky Martin Foundation was.
It built a hospital wing. It would give children in medical aid, it would give them instruments.
You know, he's always been an advocate of children, mostly children that can't help themselves.
Becoming an advocate for children's welfare gave Ricky a new perspective on his music.
It's all about awareness, it's all about talking, it's all about letting people know that there is a problem that should be attacked. And I will use my music to do this, to leave this information out there.
If he's part of something, he's part of something. He's not a fake.
Ricky, strengthened by his spiritual and social work, was now ready to take his musical career to the next level.
In
Instead of releasing another studio pop album, Ricky chose to do a live recording on MTV's Unplugged.
So during rehearsals, the flow just started going all Spanish. The idea was we were trying to make sure there were a couple English language tracks in it, but it's just the flow is so even with Spanish that one night we all looked at each other and said, this is an all Spanish record. It has to be. The flow is too beautiful right now. The ensuing record was released in the fall of 2006 and was a huge hit, selling over 2 million copies.
The Unplugged record was just, a great piece of music, a great presentation, a great package attached to how he wanted to present himself, and it was a form of growth for Ricky.
You know, all the critics who had said he's a prefabricated star, he doesn't really sing, he doesn't do this, he's just all looks and on stage, completely muzzled. Muzzle, because his voice is at its peak.
It showed that he was beyond being simply a cute guy who swiveled his hips and did dance songs. And it showed that he had evolved into someone who was serious, who is taken seriously by the industry. He can sing unplugged. In other words, he's not there lip-syncing his way through life.
Little did we know that Unplugged was going to basically solidify Ricky's position in the pantheon of the greatest, one of the greatest Latin entertainers of all time. Nobody expected that.
Ricky was back. No longer was he viewed as just another manufactured pop star.
This wasn't a comeback. It was a reaffirmation of who this guy is and his career and how long he's been doing this and why he's successful.
It does take a lot of guts to continue to believe in your art and put it out there.
I think Ricky started out as part of a manufactured marketing group, supergroup, but he certainly isn't that now. He makes his decisions. He runs his empire. He is a one-man show where he's earned the right to be the ringleader in his own circus.
He truly has found within himself a pathway. And I know that truly is a spiritual path. So, you know, his time between albums now, his thought process about where he takes a commercial venture, his charities, he has found a path that he's very comfortable with.
In the summer of 2008, Ricky announced that he had become the proud father of twin boys. The children were delivered healthy via surrogate mother. A press release stated that Ricky was elated to be a parent and that he would exit the public spotlight in order to spend time with his children.
You knew when you first met Ricky that fatherhood was in his future.
I think Ricky's going to be an incredible father. He's a very loving individual, very caring individual. And I think he made this decision out of nothing but love. And I think he's going to offer these kids a wonderful life and all the love in the world.
This was clearly another dream of Ricky Martin's. And you just got this feeling that he had reached, you know, another kind of plateau.
2 years later, in March of 2010, Ricky returned to the spotlight with another announcement. This time, he admitted what he avoided discussing for years. He said, quote, I am proud to say that I am a fortunate homosexual man.
I knew a long time ago who I was and my nature. I was very comfortable with it many years ago, and I was looking for the right way to do it. I didn't know if it was going to be through a song. I didn't know if it was going to be through an exclusive interview. I didn't know if it was going to be through a book or through Twitter like I did. But the most important thing is that it was done with it needed to be done, when I was ready, when I was completely at peace.
What motivated Ricky to finally come out was his children. Teaching them to lie was not an option.
But the most important thing was my children. Like I've said in many occasions, my children gave me the strength.
sharing with the world what he called his entire truth was liberating for Ricky.
I came out because I had the need to pretty much be free and be happy with myself. Because of who I am, I'm very happy to say that yes, I received a lot of emails and a lot of tweets from people that said, you know what, Ricky, thank you so much because you gave me the strength, you gave me the confidence to really come out to my family. And that feels amazing.
The revelation came 2 weeks after Barbara Walters admitted that pressuring Ricky to reveal his sexuality over a decade ago was inappropriate. Ricky kept his letting it all out momentum going in November of 2010. First, his memoir titled Me was released.
This book is about me creating a solid relationship with my children. My children will read this book in 10, 15 years and they will say, you know what, Daddy, I get it. I know who you are, I know what you're made of, and I'm very proud of our relationship. So that's for me the most important thing. Yes, along the way, I'm helping people to deal with acceptance.
Dedicated to his boys, the autobiography covered everything from his childhood to his sexuality. The book became a New York Times bestseller. Then, on the same day of his book's release, Ricky stopped by the Oprah Winfrey Show for a tell-all interview. Ricky gushed not only about his two sons, Matteo and Valentino, but also about his new relationship. After getting his personal life in order, Ricky was free to focus on work. In June of 2010, it was announced that Ricky will star in the upcoming Broadway revival of Evita. Then in February 2011, Ricky returned to his first love, music. His latest album, Música Alma Sexo, was released. Comprised mostly of Spanish material, the album landed at number one on Billboard's top Latin albums and number three on the Billboard Top 200. It was Latin music's highest chart debut in 15 years, proving Ricky Martin's universal appeal had not wavered. In March, the Grammy Award-winning singer decided to go on tour for the first time in 3 years. That same month, just 1 year after coming out, Ricky was honored by GLAAD for his role as a gay rights activist. Ricky Martin, talented musician, children's advocate, father, and now a proud, openly homosexual man. Where will his journey take him next?
He sees his career as, okay, we're only halfway there. We still have a long way to go.
Again, what I always believe about an artist is the wisdom that comes with the journey that comes in. I can look at Ricky's journey and know that he is focused on where he wants to be. He hasn't burned out at all. He is more focused. His voice is even better than it was before. His performance is even better than it was before.
The thing with Ricky Martin that I admire is that every step of the way, he did whatever he had to do with pride and with joy. And it seems to me that he really enjoyed the journey.
I think Ricky's just going to constantly grow.
Personal evolution, musical evolution. That's my life. What else?